So right now, I'm going to present an overview of the DSM to give you the scaffolding that can help you learn this dictionary of disorders and just an organization that you fit things into. And then we'll have Maya Yutsis, our excellent neuropsychologist who came to us from Mayo Clinic recently, talk about delirium and TBI, who's joined the family of the neurocognitive disorders and the TBI. And then Brian, who's our clinical neuropsychologist at the MIREC, who does a lot of dementia workups in our clinical patients, talk about Alzheimer's disease. Then we'll end the DSM discussion and then go to Jeff Kirchner, who's a behavioral neurologist, and we'll talk about the consensus diagnostic criteria that were pre-existing to DSM-5. And we wanted that as a balance. I think that DSM, as Ruth said, was very conservative in incorporating a lot of the biomarker information, and Jeff will give that level of sophistication that you'll have in moving forward in using those consensus diagnoses. Okay, so this is from Brian. I love this slide. Welcome to the new dictionary, and it's here. So in just giving you some organization, the neurocognitive disorders section leads off with delirium, which Maya will discuss. And that's something that we think about clinically when someone is in a delirium. We want to rule that out as something that's more acute that may have treatment implications. And then move on to the major and mild neurocognitive disorders. So that will be the organization here. So what is a neurocognitive disorder? So they're primarily cognitive and they're acquired. So this distinguishes it from, say, autism or Down's disease. And then there's an assumption of an underlying brain pathology. And for degenerative disorders, it's really important to also monitor the consensus guidelines in addition to the DSM-5. And we'll orient you to some of these. But the idea is that you can have the same symptom, say an aphasia, a language disorder, and that can be due to, say, a spongiform encephalopathy or a tauopathy. And if we find out that the brain substrate is different, they will be different disorders. It's not fully driven by the symptoms. So that's what's really critical here. So I dreaded, do we have to change our title? No, we can still be updates on dementia. So why did they call it neurocognitive disorders? And in the DSM, they explain that dementia typically refers to degenerative disorders in the elderly. And DSM wants to expand that to categories where they're disorders of younger people, HIV or traumatic brain injury. So now I'll just describe major and mild neurocognitive disorders. So for major neurocognitive disorders, and you'll see this in the diagnostic criteria for each kinds of disorder, it starts off, they have to have either major or mild neurocognitive disorder. So what is that? So for major neurocognitive disorder, there has to be a significant cognitive decline that interferes with independence. Okay, those are two critical things, but it's not due to delirium and not due to another mental disorder, the cognitive symptoms that you see. So how do we distinguish major neurocognitive disorder from dementia? Well, for major neurocognitive disorder, it can be a single domain, so an amnestic disorder would be a major neurocognitive disorder, but for some disorders, and Brian will go into this in more detail, major neurocognitive disorder due to Alzheimer's disease requires two symptom domain deficits. So here's major neurocognitive disorder. Here's minor neurocognitive disorder, you see? They just differ in the degree of cognitive decline and There is not an interference with independence, okay? So for mild neurocognitive disorder, it's like mild cognitive impairment. And previously for like MCI, it was cognitive disorder NOS. So we've incorporated it formally into the family of the DSM. So now I'm just going to talk a little bit about psychometrics. That's of relevance to us neuropsychologists. So this refers to the severity of the cognitive impairment. For mild, it's 1 to 2 standard deviations below the average score, the 3rd to 16th percentile. And major, it's 2 standard deviations, or the 3rd percentile. What does this mean? So this is a normal curve. So if you looked at everybody's IQ scores in this room, most of us would be in the middle there in the average range, or probably a little above, hopefully. You can see at the bottom, 50th percentile is average. So for patients with cognitive impairments, the mild range would be 1 to 2 standard deviations there, and the major would be below 2 standard deviations. So you see, it's really hard to get into that major neurocognitive disorder classification just by chance. It's very rare. So that represents a level of certainty that there is truly a cognitive impairment there. So given that psychometric classification, I will tell you that they should not be rigidly used, because for example, if you have an astrophysicist who's in the average range, that's probably a decline. So you have to incorporate an understanding of premorbidability, the sensitivity of your measures, or if a caregiver comes in and says, this guy can't remember anything and he can't find his way around and you don't have psychometric tests, you would be more likely to give that person a diagnosis of a major neurocognitive disorder. And there's also an understanding, and this speaks to Dr. O'Hara's comment, that major and mild exist on a continuum. We know that for at least the degenerative disorders, there's an insidious onset and progression. It's gradual, and so that we understand that that's sometimes hard to make that distinction. The cognitive domains have been changed. So rather than neurobehavioral, neurobehavioral symptoms, we're talking about additional cognitive domains. And for example, for frontotemporal dementia or MCD, there's a social cognition component. So there are other descriptors you should be aware of, the possible versus probable. So there's some inconsistency across disorders, but the underlying construct is that because these are brain disorders, especially when you have degenerative disorders, there's some level of uncertainty as to what the neural substrate is. So DSM was very conservative in talking about the criteria for probable versus possible. And then with the advances in biomarkers, as there's more level of certainty, then likely that will change. But that's the idea of the construct. You can add an additional descriptor of behavioral disturbance with or without. And the without is when the behavioral disturbance is not clinically significant. You can also talk about level of severity with respect to level of disability. And in your handouts, I made a mistake. I said instrumental. It should have been basic activity of daily living. So basically for mild, the instrumental ADLs are preserved, and moderate basic ADLs are affected, and severe, they're fully dependent. So these descriptors vary slightly across disorders, but these are the ideas behind them. So in terms of the type of neurocognitive disorders, as I said, there's delirium, and then there's the major and mild cognitive disorders, and then there's NCD due to all these different brain disorders. Okay, so now we're going to move on to the specific brain disorders. And I'm going to introduce Maya Yusis. Dr. Maya Yusis is a staff clinical neuropsychologist at the VA Palo Alto Polytrauma Transitional Rehab Program, where she primarily conducts neuropsychological assessments, decision-making capacity evaluations, and vocational assessments with patients with moderate to severe TBI, stroke, and post-surgery. She also conducts research with an emphasis on cognitive rehabilitation, functional outcomes after acquired brain injury. She also supervises neuropsychology interns, postdoctoral fellows, and PMNR residents at the Stanford University School of Medicine. She obtained her PhD in clinical psychology at Palo Alto University, completed an internship in VA Minneapolis, and a postdoctoral fellowship in clinical neuropsychology at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester. She was an instructor at the Mayo Clinic and staff neuropsychologist at the MultiCare Good Samaritan Hospital in Seattle prior to transitioning to the VA Palo Alto in 2011. So let's welcome Maya.
Everyone doing? Okay. I hope you're enjoying the coffee and lovely baked goods. So what I wanted to start talking about is delirium, and as Dr. Rosen has mentioned, that is one of the disorders included in this chapter that actually does not differentiate between mild and major NCD. So it's a little bit different from all the other disorders. The differential for delirium are the same as they were in DSM-4, and the number one differential diagnostic criteria that we see with delirium is major neurocognitive disorder, or dementia. And I think it's really key because DSM-5 has added very specific detail to the diagnosis of delirium that makes it a little bit easier to differentiate delirium from what we previously called dementia. And as you see, delirium can be due to general medical conditions, substance intoxication or withdrawal, multiple etiologies, and delirium NOS. And this is one of the disorders that has maintained its NOS specification. However, they did add an additional diagnosis, which is delirium otherwise specified. And it's a little bit confusing, but essentially it allows you to specify which symptom or which feature of delirium does not fully meet criteria for you to diagnose delirium specifically due to either substance or general medical condition. So they've also addressed that not otherwise specified. So what are some of the changes in delirium diagnosis from DSM-4 to DSM-5? One is the symptom length. They now differentiate acute delirium, which can last anywhere from hours to days, and persistent delirium, which can now last from weeks to months. And then you see that persistent specifier actually helps you a little bit in terms of differentiating long-lasting delirium from dementia or neurocognitive disorder that often comes up, especially in hospital settings where delirium happens quite often. Delirium can resolve completely or may partially resolve, and again, it has rapid onset in hours to days. DSM-5 now differentiates two diagnostic features. It used to only list reduced level of awareness to environment, and that used to include all of these aspects. Now, DSM-5 really parses out impaired attention that involves anywhere from ability to carry on a conversation, shifting attention, focusing on conversation, and lack of awareness to environment. And the number one symptom in that is disorientation to time. Usually you see it first. DSM-5 has altered a little bit the cognitive domains that could be impacted in delirium. It maintained memory, language, and perceptual disturbance as the domains that could be altered, and it added specifically visual spatial functioning as one of the domains that could also be impaired. And it's different from perceptual disturbance because it also, perceptual disturbance only addressed delusions, hallucinations, Visual spatial ability refers to people's ability to see items, judge distances, and things like that. And again, you know, associated features, and as Dr. O'Hara mentioned, this has been shown in research quite a bit, but the evidence just fully was not there to include it as key diagnostic features. And so associated features are listed as change in sleep-wake cycle, change in emotional state, mood lability, and behavior problems that you often see in delirium. So for the sake of time, I wanted to quickly move on to traumatic brain injury, and I think this is one of the diagnostic criteria that DSM-5 has actually altered quite a bit from DSM-4, because now, and I wanted to start with mild NCD, because I think that's where the confusion can begin. Mild NCD does not mean that it was a mild head injury. Mild NCD only refers to the level of cognitive decline or level of functional decline that a person experiences after head injury. Head injury could still be moderate to severe head injury, and DSM-5 now provides a pretty specific table that lists symptoms such as loss of consciousness, duration of post-traumatic amnesia, imaging findings, as the key criteria for how to diagnose severity of initial head injury. And then they address that you could still have a mild head injury even though you could have had a pretty significant or severe traumatic brain injury. And again, for mild NCD, cognitive decline should be somewhere from 1 to 2 standard deviations below the mean, or 3rd to 16th percentiles, and again, use it sparingly. But people are mostly functionally independent. DSM-5 now allows for someone to need some assistance to complete independent activities of daily living, or requiring to use more compensatory strategies like someone writing notes or keeping a calendar. That does not qualify someone to be severely functionally impaired. And again, DSM-5 now provides pretty specific list of symptoms that are typically seen after TBI that would qualify an event as a traumatic brain injury, and only one of those symptoms needs to be met. It could be either confusion or disorientation, loss of consciousness, post-traumatic amnesia, neurological signs, or imaging. As you can see, neurological signs or imaging actually are not required as part of DSM-5 criteria. It's enough to meet one of those symptoms that are medically documented. But having said that, under neurological signs, again, very specific signs are listed that was not done in DSM-4, such as onset of new seizures, worsening of seizure disorder, visual field cuts that are quite often in traumatic brain injury, anosmia, which is quite often in traumatic brain injury, and hemiparesis. So they specifically address the signs that can be seen. And so if someone needs at least one sign, that could be sufficient to diagnose someone with traumatic brain injury, and as such, neurocognitive disorder due to such injury. And again, symptom course may fully or partially recover. And as you know, with traumatic brain injury, and that actually brings me to major NCD, the typical recovery trajectory is different from the other neurodegenerative disorders. The recovery trajectory is of improvement, both in cognitive status and in functional independence. So for someone who had a moderate to severe brain injury, had an immediate onset of cognitive difficulties, and was functionally impaired and was unable to perform activities of daily living that they were able to complete before the injury, they can be diagnosed with major NCD, given the severity of cognitive decline and functional impairment. However, with time, the diagnosis can change to mild NCD due to DBI. It doesn't mean that the initial severity of head injury changed. It means the severity of decline has changed. And so that introduces that notion of continuum, that mild and major NCD really exist on a continuum. And for NCD due to DBI, the continuum is simply in a different direction from the other neurodegenerative disorders, where the continuum goes from mild to major. For DBI, it's usually major to mild. And that's what I wanted to really address for this.
Thank you.
Thank you, Maya. Maya worked with one of the leaders in the field of head injury, Bob Imnick, and so that was an excellent presentation. Thank you. So I'm going to discuss NCD associated with Lewy body disease next. And you'll notice with these DSM, these NCD, the first component is there an NCD, and then the onset, and then the disease-specific symptoms. For LBD, Lewy body disease, there has to be either a major or a mild NCD. The onset is insidious, and then the core symptoms are fluctuation in cognition, attention, or alertness, visual hallucinations that are well-formed and detailed, and Parkinsonian movement that develops 1 year after the cognitive impairment. And then there are also suggestive features, the rapid eye movement, sleep disorder, and the neuroleptic sensitivity. Just a few key issues about Lewy body disease, and again, I'm going to be very quick, because a lot of the details in the DSM. But the rapid eye movement behavioral sleep disorder is something that can appear decades before the onset of Lewy body disease. And it's not a certainty that if you have it, that you'll actually have Lewy body dementia later in life. But the disorder is essentially, there's a lack of suppression of movements during sleep. So I had a patient who had a dream of snakes in his bed and was thrashing around, and the wife didn't feel safe sleeping with him. So that's that symptom. But the reason we really wanted to describe this is the neuroleptic sensitivity issue. So you have a patient who comes to you with visual hallucinations. Psychiatrists might think, oh, let's give them antipsychotic medication. Well, these patients have neuroleptic sensitivity, so there could be a worsening of the movement disorder, the underlying movement disorder, and impairments of consciousness. It's not good for these patients to get these medications. So if you see that, then you think Lewy body disease. Again, very critical for discriminating this disorder from Parkinson's dementia is that the NCD occurs before the motor signs. In the DSM, they say it's a year lag, but of course, this is an insidious disease, and you don't know at what stage you're going to see the patient, so often that's a hard discrimination to make. The probable versus possible distinction, the way the mild and the major, I'm sorry, the way the probable and the possible descriptors are distinguished is in the number of core and suggestive features. And then with respect to fluctuations, there are existing measures of fluctuations. So for example, this might be manifest as someone who has episodes of being unable to brush their teeth or to use the washing machine. And then at other times they can, and patients, caregivers say, he can do it, he did it yesterday, but he can't do it today. Or fluctuations in alertness. So these two scales are helpful, and they're very high in discriminating these patients from other disorders. So for example, you may be able to pick out these disorders in 80% of the patients, but unless you have experience with what the fluctuations look like, often raters who are not well trained are less reliable in using them. And for Lewy body disease, these are the consensus diagnosis criteria, just so you know, in addition to DSM-5 that are also used. So we're going to move on to Brian Yoakum. Brian Yoakum is a board-certified clinical neuropsychologist working at the Mental Illness Research Education and Clinical Center, that's my group, at the VA Palo Alto, where he conducts research on the neuropsychological assessment of older adults with a focus on word finding in patients with Alzheimer's disease. He also supervises neuropsychological evaluations for older veterans in a memory clinic He's a clinical assistant professor affiliated in the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Stanford University School of Medicine. He obtained his PhD in clinical psychology at Wayne State University, completed an internship in the VA Palo Alto with a postdoctoral fellowship in clinical neuropsychology at the VA Northern California Healthcare System. He was an assistant professor at the University of Colorado in Colorado Springs before returning to VA Palo Alto in 2010. Welcome.
Dr. Rosen, for that nice introduction. I'm happy to be a part of this wonderful conference, and I'm happy to be the one to talk about my personal favorite neurocognitive disorder, Alzheimer's disease. Like Dr. O'Hara, I haven't actually been able to see this book yet, so my disclaimer is that I'm presenting what I knew to be current about a month ago. So it's probably the same now, but it may have changed. Okay. So I'm going to talk about the major and mild neurocognitive disorders due to Alzheimer's disease. Both major or mild have the requirement that there needs to be an insidious onset and a gradual progression of the cognitive impairment. So that's pretty similar to the DSM-4, nothing new there. We talked earlier how both major and mild neurocognitive disorder only require impairment in one cognitive domain. As far as I can tell, that's true for all of them except for Alzheimer's disease. The major neurocognitive disorder requires impairment in two or more cognitive domains. So that's pretty similar to the DSM-4. And of course, it also requires impaired instrumental activities of daily living or need for assistance in everyday activities. Whereas the mild NCD only requires one or more cognitive domain to be affected. And this is actually similar to mild cognitive impairment in that even if you have two domains impaired, it's still mild NCD as long as the basic IADLs are intact. Okay. I was thinking yesterday that if I prepared these slides today, I would have made a table where there's two columns and two rows with mild and major on top and possible and probable on the bottom. So if you have a patient who you suspect has Alzheimer's disease, they're going to fit into one of these four categories, which is a little bit more complex than the DSM-4, but it's manageable. So one of the things you rate them on is whether it's probable Alzheimer's disease or possible Alzheimer's disease. And this is determined mainly by if there's genetic evidence of Alzheimer's disease. And this can be from family history or formal genetic testing. Now, when I first read this, I was pretty concerned that out of the few hundred patients I've seen, I don't recall if any one of them had formal genetic testing done. So that was kind of concerning to me. But it can also be from family history, if there's a clear family history of Alzheimer's disease. But that may also require more information than I'm typically able to acquire in my clinic. I think the family history may actually include autopsy information of family members who have passed away from Alzheimer's or genetic testing done on family members. I need to read the actual book to figure that out, but that's something you can sort out. And there's more to it than that, which I'll get to here in a minute. So now I'm going to talk about major NCD due to Alzheimer's. And then I'll go into mild. So for major neurocognitive disorder due to Alzheimer's, once you figure out it's major, then you gotta figure out if it's probable or possible Alzheimer's disease. The probable Alzheimer's disease requires one of these two factors. Is this the laser? Okay. So I need either this or this. If you have the evidence of the genetic mutation, that fulfills the probable Alzheimer's disease requirement. If you don't have that, but your patient does meet the criteria for a major neurocognitive disorder, you can still call it probable Alzheimer's disease if they meet all of these three criteria. So impairment in memory, plus one other domain, history of a progressive gradual decline without peaks and plateaus so much, and no other possible primary etiology. So if your patient has a major neurocognitive disorder, and they have all three of these factors, which a lot of my patients do, then you can be confident that it's probable Alzheimer's disease. You don't have to have the genetic testing. If you don't have all this information, then you go with possible Alzheimer's disease. So that's major neurocognitive disorder. Now I'll talk about mild neurocognitive disorder due to Alzheimer's. The probable Alzheimer's disease criterion does require evidence of the Alzheimer's gene. Beyond that, if it's only a mild neurocognitive disorder and you don't have genetic information, the writers of this thought, we can't be confident enough on the conservative side that it's Alzheimer's disease, so we'll say it's possible Alzheimer's disease. So we call it possible Alzheimer's disease if there's decline in memory and learning, progressive gradual decline without the peaks and plateaus, and no evidence of other primary etiologies. Okay. So if you're like me, this brings up a whole lot of questions to discuss, which I'm happy to talk about with anyone later on. But in the interest of time, I think we should hold that off for now. And then I think there will be a question and answer period shortly after this.
Now we've completed our discussion of DSM-5, and I'm delighted to introduce Dr. Jeff Kirchner. He graduated from Harvard University and received his MD and PhD degrees from Washington University, St. Louis. He completed his neurology residency training and behavioral neurology fellowship at UCSF and has been an assistant professor of neurology and neurological sciences at Stanford University since 2009. In addition to caring for patients at Stanford Center for Memory Disorders, Dr. Kirchner studies the use of advanced imaging, neuroimaging techniques for detecting and tracking early brain changes in Alzheimer's disease. He also directs Stanford Alzheimer's Disease Clinical Trials Program. I just wanted to say also, we are recording this, and we will post this in the Stanford Geriatric Education Center website, and we also have a summary sheet with a lot of the basics, including Dr. Kirchner's summary slide in there. So it's big and you can read it. So if you don't get everything down, don't worry, we got your back on this. Anyway, Dr. Kirchner.
Good morning, everybody. So, as a neurologist who's actually, you know, out there taking care of patients, and as a scientist who's trying to recruit patients into clinical trials of new drugs and trying to do a better job at diagnosing Alzheimer's disease early, I am very frustrated by the current symptom-based diagnostic scheme that has been the state of the art for really as long as I've been in training. And so I want to talk to you this morning about what I think is a new way the field is moving in terms of trying to develop better objective tests for neurodegenerative diseases, including specifically Alzheimer's disease, that I think are going to be the way of the future and going to hopefully one day supplant the more subjective symptom-based diagnostic schemes that really don't catch disease until, frankly, it's too late. One thing I wanted to emphasize, too, just moving from the last talk, an Alzheimer's disease, familial Alzheimer's disease, genetic Alzheimer's disease, is absolutely irrelevant for 99.9, probably 100% of the people in this room, and the vast majority of people in this community. I just wanted to emphasize that detecting a gene or having a family member who has Alzheimer's disease doesn't mean that you're going to get it. The DSM is referring to a very specific, tiny minority of people in the world who get Alzheimer's disease at age 45, and that's a very different illness. Good. So let me start with the case. This is a patient who I saw in clinic recently. So it's a 68-year-old man. He came to my clinic. Actually, he really came because his wife wanted him to come. He admits that his memory isn't great, but he said, you know, gosh, isn't everybody's memory, you know, bad when you get to be my age, 68. His wife was a little bit concerned about him, though, and she described an incident that happened just a few months ago that really, in her mind, alerted her to the fact that, you know, this mild forgetfulness that she'd been seeing for a year has, in her mind, this one event really sealed the deal and proved to her that, you know, this is unusual, this is not normal. So they were planning this vacation in Las Vegas, okay? They heard about this cool hotel, the New York Hotel, that it had a roller coaster outside. And so they'd never been to Las Vegas before. You know, as a couple, they were really excited about this trip and about seeing this roller coaster, because what an interesting thing to have a roller coaster in a hotel. So they've been looking forward to this, talking about it. The day came, they flew to Las Vegas, they got in their taxi, and they rode up the strip, and they arrived at the New York Hotel, and the first thing he wanted to do is, let's go see that roller coaster and, you know, take a look at it, because we've been talking about it, you know, this whole time. So they went and took a look at it and marveled at it and said, well, we're going to go take a ride on that, but let's go check in first. So they go to the check-in desk. They hand over their credit card, their driver's license, you know, sign whatever documents they needed to sign. They're standing there at the desk, and there's another couple kind of further down the desk talking to another receptionist. The man overheard the other couple talking about this roller coaster. And he turned to his wife and he said, we need to go see that roller coaster. He had forgotten he was just there. So this was really a problem. What does he have? Does he have major or mild neurocognitive disorder? Does he have Alzheimer's disease? What do we call him? He's fully functional. He's otherwise doing everything in his life that he normally does. What am I going to call him? Do I give him a drug? Do I not? This is the main problem facing our field right now. So let me talk to you about biomarkers. What is a biomarker? A biomarker is any kind of objective measurement that your doctor can make, whether it's a blood test, a brain imaging test, a genetic test, something that can be objectively measured that serves as a proxy or as a stand-in or something that's harder to determine, like what does your brain look like at autopsy? Because frankly, what your brain looks like at autopsy is really the true gold standard definition of whether you have Alzheimer's disease or not. I haven't had a single patient volunteer for an autopsy yet. Maybe one day, but what we need are biomarkers, ways that we can try to figure out what that autopsy would show us if somehow magically we could get it. What's the use of a biomarker? Well, obviously for diagnosis, helping me with the 68-year-old man who I told you about, and also getting an earlier diagnosis, getting a sense of what somebody's brain looks like, maybe even before symptoms hit. And it's also useful for disease tracking in order to, once we have better drugs in our arsenal, and I'm optimistic that we will, being able to tell, is the drug working? You know, repeat the blood test, and is there a sign that the Alzheimer's-associated biomarker changes are getting better in response to the drug? Now, a lot of people say, why bother? Why bother getting a diagnostic test for a disease that we can't cure, that we can't even treat very well? Why bother giving people, you know, the certainty that they have Alzheimer's disease and to make them feel badly about having that diagnosis when there isn't anything we can do? Well, first of all, my patients are asking me for that diagnosis. They want to know what's wrong with them, even if there's not anything that they can specifically do now that's going to cure their illness. They still want to know what's affecting them. So my patients are asking me for a good diagnosis. And again, I'm optimistic that the situation with drugs and other
treatments for dementia are going to get better. And for sure, the new drugs that are coming out are not going to be effective in people who are already drooling on themselves, rolled back to the back of the nursing home, severely demented. Those are not the people who the drugs are going to help. The drugs are going to help those of us who do not yet know that we have Alzheimer's disease, whose brain might be undergoing changes, but we don't have symptoms yet, or those symptoms are very mild. And so we need biomarker tests to be able to pick out those people who are going to benefit from drugs. And in addition, as we're trying to figure out whether our drugs work or not, we can use biomarkers as a way to, instead of having a two-year clinical trial to see whether somebody's memory has really improved, maybe we could have a six-month clinical trial and see whether a person's Alzheimer's disease biomarkers appear to be improving in response to the drug. There are two broad categories of biomarkers for Alzheimer's disease. There are so-called biomarkers of amyloidosis. So you may have heard of the plaques in the brain in Alzheimer's disease. Plaques are made of a protein called beta amyloid. So a biomarker of amyloidosis is really trying to tell you something about whether there are amyloid plaques in the brain. And these include a couple of things. CSF measurements of the beta amyloid protein, and also a new technology that I'll tell you about called amyloid PET imaging. The other broad category are biomarkers of neuronal injury. Okay, so that's a marker that brain cells are actually dying, all right? This includes measurements of cerebral spinal fluid, another protein called tau, a brain imaging technology called FDG PET that's been around for a long time, and another brain imaging technology that's also been around for a long time, and that's MRI scanning. So the reason why we need two different types of markers for Alzheimer's disease is because there are two different types of changes in the brain that we see at autopsy. One, I already mentioned the amyloid plaques, that's these things, and there are tangles, collections of the tau protein. The neuropathologist, the autopsy doctor, has to see both changes in the brain in order to say that this brain has Alzheimer's disease. And so our biomarkers need to be sensitive to these two different manifestations, these two different molecular signatures of the illness. What I'm about to show you is kind of fictional, probably not true, but it encapsulates what the way many people think of the way Alzheimer's disease develops in the brain. Many scientists believe that the deposition of beta amyloid, those plaques that I showed you, is probably one of the earliest things to happen in the brain. And in fact, it probably happens when you're completely normal. I might have a head full of amyloid, I don't know. Certainly by the time you develop mild cognitive impairment, the amyloid's already there, and it's probably nearly maximal. If you're not collecting a whole lot more of it, it's already all over the brain. The next step is probably the accumulation of those tau tangles, that other feature that I showed you on the microscope slide, and the death of neurons. So that probably happens at a later stage than the deposition of plaques. The cognitive decline happens after all of that. In part, this slide reflects some good news. The good news is that your brain is remarkably resilient to damage. Your brain can take a lot of plaques, a lot of tangles, in fact, a lot of death of neurons before you have this, the subtlest symptom. But you could also flip that and say that that's bad news, because by the time somebody comes to my clinic with symptoms, their brain looks like a war zone under the microscope. They've already had a head full of amyloid, a head full of tau, and dead and dying neurons in their brain. So by the time you have symptoms, a lot of damage has already been done. Let me tell you about a new technology called amyloid PET imaging. So this is an updates conference. This is a technology that was FDA approved about a year ago, and it's now being done at centers in the Bay Area, including at Stanford. It's not yet covered by insurance, so this is an expensive test. But what this technology allows us to do, a PET scan is when you get injected with a radioactive compound that attaches to something. And in this case, if you get injected with a radioactive compound that specifically binds to beta amyloid, you then shake the patient up, put them in a PET scanner, and see whether any of that radioactive stuff stuck in the brain. And if it did, then that tells you that there are amyloid plaques in the brain. And so here's an example of a individual who really doesn't have any evidence of that tracer. So there's bright stuff here in the middle of the brain, but around the outside of the brain, where there's the cerebral cortex, the gray matter of the brain, there's really not much to speak of in terms of tracer uptake. Now, this study that I'm showing you was designed to be of patients who were about to die from some other cause. Maybe they had cancer or end-stage heart failure or something. And so when this individual died, they did an autopsy and they looked to see how good of a job does this tracer do at really telling us how much amyloid is in the brain. And the answer is that it did a good job. So this person's brain really doesn't have any amyloid plaques in it. It looks healthy. So the tracer did a good job here. Here's an individual who was 78 when he or she died. There's a mild degree. You can see that this scan is different from the one above it. And there's a mild degree of this tracer uptake around the outside of the brain and the gray matter. And in fact, there's a mild to moderate degree of plaques in this person's brain at autopsy. Let's look at this last example, a 79-year-old individual whose brain is really hot, very positive. A lot of this tracer got stuck in the brain. And this person's brain is absolutely littered with amyloid plaques. So this technology is actually extremely good, extremely sensitive at telling us which patients have amyloid plaques in their brains and who doesn't. Is that the same thing as a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease? No, remember I told you can't just have plaques in your brain, you also have to have those tangles in your brain. And you have to have symptoms, you have to have cognitive decline in order to really carry a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. Okay, let me tell you a bit about another set of biomarkers. So because the last test that I showed you is extremely expensive, and also because it only gives you a window on the one aspect of the pathology in Alzheimer's disease. It only tells you about plaques, but not the tangles. I actually do a lot of spinal taps, lumbar punctures in my clinic. So this is a procedure that allows you to measure actually the level of that beta amyloid protein, that exact same protein that the PET tracer in the last slide is binding to in the brain. I can measure the level of that protein in your spinal fluid. I can also measure the level of tau protein. This is what makes up the tangles in your brain. And there's a version of that tau protein that's phosphorylated that's particularly specific for Alzheimer's disease. So you can measure all of these proteins in the spinal fluid. It turns out, for reasons that are not entirely clear, that the amyloid level in your spinal fluid actually goes down in Alzheimer's disease, maybe because it's accumulating in the brain. Maybe the problem is that we all have amyloid beta in our brains and in our spinal fluid, and maybe the problem in Alzheimer's disease is that it's getting stuck in the brain and it's not getting drained into your spinal fluid. Having a low A-beta in your spinal fluid is really the same thing as having a positive amyloid scan. In addition, the tau levels in your spinal fluid go up, and this probably just reflects neurons dying. As neurons die, they spill their contents. Tau is one of those contents, and the level of tau in your spinal fluid goes up. Actually, a lot of other neurodegenerative diseases can have elevated levels of tau. So this isn't necessarily specific for Alzheimer's disease. So I'm going to tell you about another technology. So the previous two things that I showed you were biomarkers of amyloidosis, so the amyloid PET scan and measuring the spinal fluid amyloid levels. Those are measures of amyloidosis. Measuring spinal fluid tau levels and this technology, metabolic imaging, these are markers of neuronal injury. Okay. So FDG PET, or fluorodeoxyglucose PET for the aficionados in the room, this is a technology that's been around for a long time. SPECT scanning has been around for even longer and is less sensitive. And arterial spin labeling MRI is a newer technology that's that some centers are starting to use on a kind of experimental basis. All of these do one main thing. That is, they highlight parts of your brain that are working hard, and they show as being cold areas of the brain that are not working very much at all. And so in neurodegenerative diseases, Alzheimer's disease is a great example. Alzheimer's disease is not a disease of the entire brain. The frontal lobes of your brain in Alzheimer's disease are often very much preserved. Social skills, human warmth, social comportment, all of these things stay pretty preserved until very late stages of Alzheimer's disease. But memory and visual spatial reasoning and language function, things that occur in the back of the brain, those kinds of skills often deteriorate early in Alzheimer's disease. And so what these technologies help you to see are what areas of the brain are not burning calories versus what areas of the brain are burning calories. And the pattern can help you to understand what the right diagnosis is. So these technologies tell us the presence and the pattern of any area of the brain that is not functioning well. Unfortunately, it doesn't tell us what the cause is for that particular brain area not working well. So this is not actually a direct marker of amyloid or of tau. And so it is limited in that way. And unfortunately, in my clinic, I don't order a lot of these tests because the times when I'm tempted to order it, it's usually in an unusual patient who has an odd mixture of symptoms. And it's actually in those patients in whom this kind of testing is least informative. Structural MRI. So whenever you go to get an MRI, whether it's of your knee or of your brain or of some other body part, you're getting a structural MRI scan. And we get structural MRI scans of patients complaining of memory problems all the time. The main reason to get a structural MRI is to make sure that the patient hasn't had a stroke or hasn't had a brain tumor or hasn't had some other thing going on in their brain that could explain their memory problem that would take me as their doctor down a completely different pathway. But in addition, there's research going on that there may be things that we can measure structurally in the brain that might tell us something about whether Alzheimer's disease is present or not. So this is actually an important area of my personal research, and so I'm going to unabashedly show you some of the images from my work. So this is a 7 Tesla high-resolution picture of somebody's brain showing my favorite part of the brain, which is the hippocampus. And so one biomarker of Alzheimer's disease may be to measure the size of the hippocampus or subfields, fine areas within the hippocampus that might tell us whether Alzheimer's disease is present or not. So the criteria that I use as a clinical researcher and as a practicing neurologist are actually a little bit different from the diagnostic and statistical manual. But philosophically, I think we share our opinions about things. So mild cognitive impairment, there's a symptom. There's a concern about a change in cognition. There's an impairment in one or more cognitive domains. You're still functioning independently, and you're not demented. So this sounds a lot like the mild neurocognitive disorder that you've heard other individuals talk about earlier. Alzheimer's disease. Well, you have to have dementia to be diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. And this includes a loss of functional independence, interfering with work or usual activities, and it has to represent a decline. It's not due to delirium or another psychiatric disease, and you have to have impairment in at least 2 cognitive domains. Memory doesn't have to be one of them. The onset has to be insidious. There has to be worsening over time, either from the patient or the caregiver's report, or from me as a clinician if I've seen a patient at 2 time points. There has to be worsening over time. And usually the cognitive deficits are either amnestic or non-amnestic. Well, that kind of includes everybody. And there's no competing process going on that could explain the disorder. And you've already heard the terms probable, In my world, probable Alzheimer's disease fits all of these criteria. And possible Alzheimer's disease is atypical in some way, either the presentation is a little unusual or the course is not well defined. So how do we use biomarkers to help to inform these research criteria? This is now being done all the time in clinical research. If anybody you know is enrolled in a clinical trial for Alzheimer's disease, virtually all clinical trials for Alzheimer's disease require that you get a biomarker test to prove or to heighten the likelihood that you have Alzheimer's disease before you're even allowed to participate. And in patients in my clinic, unusual patients, the 55-year-old with cognitive decline who's too young to have Alzheimer's disease, I get biomarker tests on a routine basis to help me to understand what's really going on with this person. In research, we have preclinical criteria, or because recognizing that people may have changes in their brain well before they actually have symptoms of Alzheimer's disease. And preclinical stages of Alzheimer's disease are defined in three stages. So stage one, there's evidence of amyloidosis in the brain. So in other words, there's evidence that you have plaques, either by amyloid PET imaging or by having a reduced CSF A-beta concentration. But there's no evidence of neuronal injury. And of course, by definition, there's no cognitive decline and no functional decline. Stage two, also no cognitive or functional decline, but in addition to amyloidosis, you have to have a marker of neuronal injury, so an FDG PET scan that's abnormal or an elevated level of CSF tau. Preclinical stage three, this is where maybe if Dr. Rosen really examines you closely as a neuropsychologist, maybe there's some subtle evidence of a cognitive problem, or maybe your wife or your husband complains, you know, things are not quite the same, even though my astrophysicist husband still scores normally on testing. You know, there's been a change, I think. So preclinical stage three is when there's some evidence of a clinical, a little bit of cognitive decline, and amyloidosis and neuronal injury. What about mild cognitive impairment? So I showed you the clinical criteria for mild cognitive impairment, and I can diagnose MCI even in the absence of any information about amyloidosis or neuronal injury. But if I do some biomarker tests, if I were to get some test results that showed no evidence of amyloidosis and no evidence of neuronal injury, that would tell me that this person's mild cognitive impairment is less likely or unlikely due to Alzheimer's disease and probably is due to something else, maybe Lewy body disease, maybe frontotemporal dementia. If one of those types of biomarkers is positive and the other isn't, in other words, if there's evidence of amyloidosis but no evidence of neuronal injury, then there's an intermediate likelihood of Alzheimer's disease, and if both are positive, I would say that that patient has a high likelihood of Alzheimer's disease. Once you're demented and you have Alzheimer's disease, again, the same scheme applies, where if I don't have any biomarker information, I can still give somebody a clinical diagnosis of possible or probable Alzheimer's disease. Having one biomarker positive but not the other tells me that there's an intermediate likelihood. And if both types of biomarkers are positive, this tells me there's a high likelihood. So, in case you can't remember everything on this slide, it's all available online. This is printed on the slide handout as well. Let me give you a quick caution. I am running out of time, but I want to emphasize that a clinical diagnosis that I make in when I wear my hat as a doctor is different from a research diagnosis that I make when I'm wearing a hat as a clinical researcher. Okay, how are they different? Well, for instance, in the real world, in the clinical world, there is no such thing as a preclinical case of Alzheimer's disease. If you come to my clinic as a normal person, you have no complaint about your cognition, your husband or wife doesn't have a complaint about your cognition, and you say, Dr. Kirshner, will you do an amyloid PET scan on me? I will say no. I will say no, because there's no reason to do that test in you if you don't have a symptom. And if it were positive, I don't know what I would do about that. You might get depressed. You might, you know, change your will, and I wouldn't want any of that to happen. Biomarker tests are often, I often don't offer these tests to symptomatic people. The 87-year-old patient who has a progressive amnesia, she can't form new memories, she has some word-finding difficulty, and can't navigate around her neighborhood, she's got Alzheimer's disease. And I'm about 90 to 95% correct when I say that in that 87-year-old patient compared to autopsy. I don't need a biomarker test to help me. And the other important point is that a lot of the research, and I could spend hours telling you about the research that backs up all these different biomarkers that we talked about, that research is done on a clinical research population where patients are clean. They have nothing else wrong with them except for their Alzheimer's disease. Do you think that happens a lot in the real world? No. So patients in the real world have a lot of other things going on. Patients in the real world are heterogeneous. And we don't know a whole lot about how these biomarker tests, how well they work in the real clinical world. The more subtle problem with the biomarkers is that this nice, pretty scheme that I'm showing you, where there's a smooth movement from getting amyloid in your brain to then having neuronal injury to then having cognitive decline, this scheme might not be right. And some patients might have tau-based problems, neuronal injury, that happened before amyloidosis. Some patients might get things out of order. And, you know, a lot of us, in fact, how many in the room are 70 or older? So a few of you. So a third of you have a head full of amyloid. A third of you have a head full of amyloid, and we don't know what that means. We don't know whether that means you're going to get Alzheimer's disease one day. There's actually evidence from autopsies that people can live to the ripe old age of 100 and something with amyloid in their brain and not have symptoms of cognitive decline. Maybe some people can tolerate that amyloid better than others. So in my last 2 minutes, I'm just going to give you some examples of cases that I might encounter in the clinic where the use of biomarkers might be helpful to me. So take the example of a 56-year-old woman who comes to my clinic who has problems with language. She has word-finding problems and also has trouble pronouncing words correctly, so it's really some strange problems with language. And I'm trying to figure out, is this Alzheimer's disease or is it a type of frontotemporal dementia? Because both are roughly equally common in this age group. So maybe I'll get a structural MRI scan that shows no evidence of frontal lobe or temporal lobe atrophy, and maybe I'll do a spinal tap and I'll see that her A-beta is abnormal and her tau level is abnormal. And this might lead me to the conclusion that this patient has a high likelihood of having Alzheimer's disease as the cause of her symptoms. What about an 87-year-old woman who's morose, withdrawn, tearful, not paying attention to her basic care needs? She's not eating well. She's not going out of the house. She's not shopping. And we're trying to figure out, is she just depressed or does she have Alzheimer's disease? We tried to get a neuropsychological evaluation on her, but she was just too tearful and she couldn't participate. But an amyloid PET scan that's negative in a patient like this would really be pretty convincing evidence that at least Alzheimer's disease isn't present. It's not proof she might have frontotemporal dementia or she might have Lewy body disease, but at least that's pretty good evidence that she doesn't have Alzheimer's disease. Finally, what about a 62-year-old man who's become subtly forgetful and feels like he has to work harder at work just to kind of keep up? How many of you in the room feel like you're in that category? So does this person have mild cognitive impairment, or is this just normal aging and he needs to just bite his lip and push through it? Well, maybe I got a neuropsychological assessment that shows some borderline impairment, but not, you know, clear impairment and delayed memory. And maybe I got a spinal fluid test and one of the tests was abnormal, the A-beta level was a little bit low and the tau level looked normal. Here's an example where I'm not really any further ahead after having done my testing. So there are some cases where biomarkers don't add a lot to the clinical formulation. So I think we're moving into a phase of question and answer now.
Thanks, that was fantastic. So we can take a few questions. We went over a little bit. Yes.
No one has mentioned
on
the
old-term vascular
dementia. Can you make
any comments on that? So that's in the DSM. Oh, sorry. So what about vascular dementia? That's dear to my heart. It's in the DSM. We didn't go over it here just in the interest of time. But I would just refer you to the DSM because I wouldn't want to take the time to go through. It looks pretty similar in my quick read. Any other questions? Yes.
So in the real world of primary care, neuropsychological testing is not readily available. What are the implications for diagnosis of these neurocognitive disorders in the absence of access to
medication? The question is, what do we do if we don't have neuropsychological testing in the real world of primary care? And I don't think it's absolutely necessary for the diagnostic criteria, but you would have to have convincing evidence that there's a cognitive decline. As a neuropsychologist, I feel you'd be more sensitive to subtle declines, and you could discriminate premorbid expectations from subtle declines, but it's not absolutely critical for the DSM. Does that, and Brian, why don't you come up?
Two answers to that. We need to hire more neuropsychologists. The DSM-5 actually includes some informal bedside sort of tests, because the writers are aware that there's a major shortage of testing available, and we take a while to get done. So there's a lot of bedside tests listed in there.
Okay,
so close.
One more question. Yes?
Starting again. With the information regarding being able to give a probable diagnosis of Alzheimer's with a family history, what degree relative does the family history have to have? Is it a parent, grandparent, auntie? What is it?
Okay, I'm going to let Jeff answer that.
So I haven't read the DSM, but what they're referring to is familial Alzheimer's disease. The question is, to have a genetic history of Alzheimer's disease, what constitutes a genetic, a family history? And you have to have either a convincing autosomal dominant pattern of history, where 50% of the people in the family got Alzheimer's disease at age 45. And ideally, you'd have genetic testing that shows one of three genes is mutated: the amyloid precursor protein, presenilin 1, or presenilin 2. In other words, a known mutation in one of those genes. Again, it's extraordinarily rare to encounter a patient off the street who happens to fit in that category. That's not a diagnosis that a primary care doctor is ever likely to make in their entire career.
So I want to introduce Ruth O'Hara. Dr. Ruth O'Hara's research aims to identify the physiological markers of neurocognitive impairment in a broad range of late-life disorders, including mild cognitive impairment, Alzheimer's disease, late-life depression, and late-life anxiety disorders. Using neuroimaging and genetic approaches to investigating the impact of psychological and physiological stress, and more recently, sleep disorders, her research aims to more fully characterize the genetic risk factors and physiological mechanisms underlying normal and pathological cognitive impairment, and to insist in early identification of those at greatest risk for cognitive decline and dementia, and also to increase our understanding of the role of cognitive impairment in exacerbating late-life psychiatric disorders, and ultimately to develop interventions aimed at reducing this impairment. Dr. O'Hara?
Thank you. Well, first I'd like to say a big thank you to Allyson and all of the organizers, Elizabeth and others, who've done just a stellar job, and also very delighted to be presenting on this topic. And for those of you who have those stress markers, I didn't even do mine because, as you know, the DSM-5 has been actually a significant source of interesting stress reactivity in those of us who worked on it, didn't work on it, and even Tom Insel, I've heard. For those of you who've been following the press, there has been a certain amount of controversy. And I think one of the dilemmas has been really a lack of explication of the process at least involved. So what I want to do this morning is just very briefly really give you an overview of what those of us on the DSM-5 actually were engaged in as a process, and what was the level of both scientific and clinical oversight, so that you have a sense where this document is coming from. So I have no financial relationship, despite press reports and even journal articles to the contrary, I assure you. I'm a cognitive neuroscientist and still buy my shoes and pay less, so I don't have any financial relationships with the pharmaceutical industry or any industry. I do have to disclose I'm a member of the DSM-5 Sleep Wake Work Group, though. And in that capacity, not only worked on my own specific disorder that I was assigned, but also in addition, I was the Wake Work Group editor. So I reviewed all chapters and I'll go through this process. And this presentation really refers to the work as it was ongoing. I want to give you a sense today of the progress and the process. It's not the final DSM-5 criteria, which Allyson will speak about. And I have to tell you, despite being the text editor, which means I got the proofs from my own section, we did not literally know till the book came out exactly what were the criteria that made it in and didn't. Now, that may sound a little bit more of a random process than it actually was. It just meant there were, you know, some fine-grained final decisions. But fortunately, Allyson has all that information for you today for your cognitive disorders. One of my colleagues, actually, who comes from the Neurocognitive Disorder Work Group, said that having served on DSM-5, she was hoping now to go into witness protection. But, so, what is diagnosis? Well, its origin is from the Greek, meaning through knowledge. And it means determining the nature and the causes of an illness by studying symptoms. And certainly in the field of mental health, we are highly reliant on symptoms for our nosological structure. Unlike other disorders like heart and other organs, where really you can get a defined look at the operations of that organ, in the field of the brain, as you know, if you open one section of the brain and just look at it with the naked eye, it looks much like any other section of the brain. And so it's taken us a long time to develop the adequate methodologies and sophisticated technologies to give us the kind of insight into this CNS system that other aspects of medical science have had a huge advantage on for years, not the least because those organs are a little more defined. We have the most complex potential organ to look at, and that's why I think in many parts we still are very symptom-oriented. Symptoms are also what present to the clinician. They don't have the fMRI or the genetic marker at their fingertips necessarily, and why that may be the wave of the future. Currently, we're still dependent on an osteological system that best articulates those symptoms which map best onto specific disorders. And diagnosis is generally the most important part of it, the first step in actually getting to treatments. So the history of the DSM, actually, for those of you who may be interested, started in 1844 with the formation of the Association of the Mental Institution Superintendents. And one specified goal to collect statistical information on what was then termed insanity. So I think an important component of DSM-5 that is much ignored is in fact the statistical component. And it's a measure of the rigor of the DSM-5 that actually their statistical supervisor, to give it a better phrase, is our own at Stanford, Helena Kramer, who is an internationally renowned biostatistician, who really sensibly applies statistical techniques to psychiatric disorders. It has made its way through several iterations, the most recent being the one that has just come out this week. So the one thing we have to remember when we're talking about DSM-5 is its primary purpose. The primary purpose is to enhance clinical utility, diagnostic reliability, and diagnostic validity. Additionally, it's to provide criteria for diagnostic categories so that we can have help clinicians and researchers reliably diagnose, communicate about, research, and treat people with mental health disorders. Now, one of the areas of controversy in the DSM-5 has been the reliability of the field trials. And I don't know how many of you are familiar with this, but what happens in the process of putting the DSM-5 diagnostic categories or criteria together is trying to operationalize them across multiple settings using field trials. And it's very interesting, we did the same thing for DSM-4. Now, the difference is that in DSM-5, the reliabilities went down. So immediately people feel that that actually reflects differences in the criteria. Well, there's two things that I want to underscore. First is they did not go down for all disorders. They went down for some of the disorders that transpired to be the most complex, and some of the ones where we have most difficulty actually discriminating them from other disorders. And one case is the overlap between mood and anxiety, for example. So for some of our very defined phenotypes, the reliability is actually increased. In part, another factor that played into this was that for the DSM-4 field trials, there was actually a very systematic pre-screening, as it were. So we were somewhat loading the deck in that it's like an efficacy trial where you're taking the best possible patients to fit those criteria and then doing the reliability. This, in the DSM-5, they actually drew much more from the general population. So there was a significant number of what we see in real life practice, comorbidities and concurrent disorders. And these aspects certainly reduce reliability, diagnostic reliability, but they are in fact the reality. So in many ways, I believe that the reliability rates we see reflect more on the state of where we are in terms of our science of mental health disorders, not on limitations of the DSM-5 per se. That's my own perspective, and this is all my own perspective. And the other aspects in terms of research, what were the major changes? So there were sort of, several categories, five major categories of changes. There was a radical simplification. It was felt that we had started to become a little bit like the international classification system, where there were too many breakdowns among disorders and distinctions. And this is particularly at odds with the efforts of NIMH, which is hoping to go for more dimensional approaches that really better capture the symptoms across transdiagnostic categories. So in a sense, there was an effort by DSM to go for a more dimensional approach that captured and fit best with this when the science was there, when the best evidence supported it. So there has been, for example, the category of not otherwise specified was pretty much eliminated whenever possible. And we also moved away from causal attribution. And there are many reasons for this. When a clinician sees a patient in a clinical setting, they don't know which came first, the sleep disorder or the depression, but it's very important to actually look at those together and to consider them both. So there was an increased sort of emphasis on considering comorbid psychiatric and medical disorders and not having to worry about which was secondary to or due to. And in no small part, that also reflects the fact that at this stage, many of us have not had the longitudinal studies at our fingertips. They have not been done, which can truly define the temporal sequence between these disorders in a way that we really have assurance of which comes first or which comes second. In a recent editorial in the American Journal of Psychiatry, Susan Schultz underscored that in terms of cognitive function and late life depression, we need to be concerned about looking at both, less concerned about which comes first. An emphasis on dimensional measures of severity. Originally, there was a hope for dimensional measures of diagnosis, but those proved too difficult at this stage, and again, the evidence base wasn't there. And also an emphasis on incorporating major scientific and clinical advances. And I think this is a significant strength of DSM-5, that there was a tremendous amount of scientific rigor and definition of what rose to the level of being appropriate for our inclusion in the DSM-5. An emphasis also, increased emphasis on both developmental and lifespan approaches. So for example, an increased emphasis on the functional consequences across the lifespan for every disorder. So there's a section that actually tracks developmental course in each of your chapters. variations in dementia measures across the lifespan by gender and by race and ethnicity, increased consideration of making sure that we have accounted for gender differences, ethnic differences, and age differences in our criteria, in our diagnostic presentations. And also an increased acknowledgement of the importance of associated comorbid, or what we might call at least concurrent, medical and psychiatric conditions. So just to give you a little bit of an idea of the process, and this was started, I came on in 2009, and many people joined before that. I think the first meetings were as early as 2003. So the chair and the vice chair of the process for writing the DSM-5 is David Cutler, superb psychiatrist from the University of Pittsburgh, and also Daryl Rieger, who is at the APA. They had our task force, which included Helena Kramer, and many of what we would consider to be leaders in different diagnostic areas like mood. Philip Jesse, for example, headed up the Neurocognitive Disorder Group, which you will be hearing about today. And I'm sorry this is in red, it's how it came out for me from the website, but they formed 13 work groups then, which were actually disorder specific. And within these 13 work groups, you have the neurocognitive disorders, the sleep-wake disorders, for example, where I serve. So those, the formation of those work groups took approximately about a year to 18 months, in no small part because of conflicts of interest. The actual bar, the spike media for conflicts of interest in DSM-5 was set extremely high. Nobody could have more than 10,000 in personal income that came from any kind of extra consulting and so forth, which is actually one of the most conservative bars set. And many of us have absolutely no conflicts whatsoever. And if people had more than that, they could not serve. There's also advisors, though, so that we kept individuals in the loop who were significant experts but weren't part of the work group. Also, there was a limit on the number of individuals from any given institution, so that you really were getting a heterogeneous group of individuals with all sorts of perspectives represented. So we had, as I said, the Conflicts of Interest Committee. Then we had the DSM-5 Process Committee. And one of the ones I worked mostly closely with, the Scientific Review Committee. Every chapter of the DSM-5 was written and reviewed by their own group and advisors multiple times before being forwarded to the Scientific Review Committee to check the evidence base. This included Bob Friedman, who's at the University of Colorado and is the editor of the American Journal of Psychiatry. I don't know how Bob got the time, but he reviewed every single chapter, often not once or twice, but sometimes three times. And also Ken Kendall from Virginia Commonwealth, who's an excellent biostatistical geneticist and psychiatrist. And so just to give you an example of the kind of evidence, for in genetic markers, many of which did not make it into the DSM-5, you would see that in your own neurocognitive disorders, as diagnostic markers, they made it into the text, but the bar was the JAMA criteria for independent replications of any genetic effect. So it was a very high bar for the evidence base. The Clinical and Public Health Review Committee, consultants for field trials, and then there was forensic review, as well as individuals who checked that we had done enough on ethnicity, gender, and age. So it really was a fairly comprehensive and actually, I would say, tiring process. Here is one of, and for those of you who are just in doubt, on-page process. This was a second job for most of us who actually served. For sections that were incomplete or lacked data, when we wrote a chapter, we had to provide the level of evidence that it was, this had not been addressed, it might be an issue that had not been addressed in systematic research, so no conclusion or assertion can be provided, or it had been addressed, but the evidence was simply not there yet. And there was actually very defined criteria that we utilized, so that some people, I think, feel, for example, I'll tell you one of the issues we dealt with, is that nightmares have now been proposed as preceding the onset of PTSD, for example. The evidence base was considered exciting, but sufficient evidence wasn't there. So the DSM-5 veered on the more conservative end if the evidence base wasn't there. And this is the same with the neurocognitive. So sometimes there are exciting developments in the field, and I think some individuals feel it would have been nice to have them in the DSM-5, but if the evidence base wasn't there, if it was felt that it wasn't useful, or indeed it was important, not to in fact put it in at this point. Most of those are referred to in the text, and the DSM-5 is a living document, so that's why we call it 5 and didn't stick with the Roman numerals, because it's now going to go to 5.1, 5.2, with the goal that there's rapid updates on a regular basis in the weight of good scientific and clinical data. So here is the Neurocognitive Work Group, which, as I said, was headed by Doug Jesse, who's also outgoing president of the APA. It had Ron Peterson, who has done most of the work, seminal work in biocognitive impairment, with the rest of us following, Igor Grant at UCSD, Murray Ganguly, I mean, really superb clinicians. And it was about a three-year process, most of the work groups meeting at least twice a month, and then weekly as they got into the kind of nitty-gritty. So just to say that no matter whether one disagrees or agrees with the premise of the nosological system, or feels that the criteria don't capture what they're seeing, it was at least a rigorous process, and I think that's the important thing for me to underscore today.